Hi, it's John here. Like everybody else, due to recent events, I've been stuck at home, and today, because of the weather, I'm stuck in the home, and I've been reading up on some things that are laying around, so I thought today we might talk a little bit about the Springfield trapdoor rifles that the U.S. used after the Civil War and up into the 1890s. These were originally modifications of the muzzle-loading rifle musket of the Civil War, and later they were newly built rifles like this piece, which required you to cock the hammer, open the trapdoor, and single load a metallic cartridge round. I've seen several videos of these online. Most of them just refer to one particular model and may talk about the others. I happen to have a number of variations of the infantry rifles here. I don't have any of the cavalry carbines. There, of course, were a number of those. I tend toward collecting infantry weapons, and cavalry carbines are more expensive. So I'll get the camera around where we can see the rest of these, and then we'll talk a little bit about each one. So I've started off already lying to you. We're not looking at the rifles yet. We need a little bit of background first. At the beginning of the American Civil War, the Springfield Armory was producing the model of 1861 rifle musket, which was itself a simplification of the model 1855 that had been built at both Springfield and Harper's Ferry up to that point. Harper's Ferry, of course, was an early casualty of the war, being burned and having its remaining material removed by the Confederates to be used in Richmond and elsewhere, which left Springfield as the only government-owned arsenal going into the conflict. So the Model 1861 was put into production. Their production was ramped up year over year, as often happens in wartime. And it was considered so important because it was the primary infantry arm that they were actually ordered by Congress not to work on anything else. No research and development or anything of that nature. They were just supposed to put out as many rifle muskets as they could. Now, over the course of the war, because of a story it deserves all by itself, the Model 1861 was replaced. There were three main rifle muskets. They were all very similar, but had cosmetic and some simplification differences. The Model 1861 was built from 61 to 63. The Model 1863 was built, I believe, beginning in 1863 and 64, and the Model 1864 in 64 and 65. You'll hear collectors call the last two the Model 1863 Type 1 and 1863 Type 2. From what I've read in the books, the armory considered them to be the Model 1863 and 1864. This is a model of 1864 musket made at Springfield with a lock date of 1864. It's 56 inches long. It's a muzzle-loading rifled musket. It has three barrel bands. Much of the difference cosmetically between these has to do with the style of the bands. We'll talk about that later. It's important to talk about this because all of these trapdoor rifles are going to be variations of this. One thing I'd like you to notice right here, this is sort of out of turn, but you've got the lock plate itself and the hammer for the percussion nipple and this bolster with the eagle on it, which takes is attached to the barrel, and there's a cutout here in the lock plate for that. That's going to change in the rifles we're looking at today. But I just wanted you to see that on the rifle musket so you could see what was there originally. We've got a dual flip-up sight here, which kind of sticks, but you've got a 100-yard battle sight, a 300-yard notch on the top of this leaf, and a 500-yard notch on the top of that leaf. Also note this screw here with the two little holes in it, to be removed by some sort of pliers for the rear sight. I'll be talking about that in a moment also. So the armory was under orders to manufacture as many of these as they could, and they made roughly equal numbers of the 1861, 63, and 64. They could see, however, that these muzzle loaders were not the way of the future. There were many breech-loading arms already involved in the war that had metallic cartridges. Most of them were carbines for the cavalry. Some were larger, but none of them had the punch that the rifle musket already had. This is an actual Frankfurt Arsenal-made paper cartridge for this musket. It actually should be pointing this way because there is the 500-grain lead mini ball, in this end, and 60 grains of black powder we'd say now, in this end. And of course you would rip it open and pour those down the muzzle and ram them in and fire it. But there were several other types of cavalry carbine and some rifles. You had the Spencer rifle, which we have a 56-56 round here from the Spencer wartime round, and a post-war version of the 44 Henry rimfire round. One thing you'll note here is that the powder capacity of these and the bullet size is not near the size of that paper cartridge. So one of the demands for the Army when they were going to adopt a breech loader was that it have ballistics equal to the punch of that 500 grain mini bullet. And the actions of these early breech loaders were not up to that sort of thing. So despite them being under orders not to attempt development, in 1864, one of the men who worked at the arsenal, Erskine Allin, and that's A-L-L-I-N, filed a patent for a breech mechanism that later would become known as the trapdoor. They developed a round that they thought would equal the ballistics of the paper cartridge. It's the 58 rimfire round. It has rimfire ignition, a copper cartridge case, a 500 grain bullet, and 60 grains of powder. So that's what the first rifle we're looking at was developed for. One other thing I want to talk about while we're here with the musket is the bayonet. And I'm getting a little ahead of myself here. But here is a Model 1855 bayonet, which was used on all the versions of the Springfield rifle musket and would continue to be used on the early versions of the trapdoor. It's the socket bayonet. It goes on over the front sight, slots in thus, turn, push it in place, and lock the ring. As I said, remember that. That will be carrying on into what we're going to talk about next. Okay, these things are really long. I was trying to get the camera up high enough to take a picture of all of them at once, and that's just a little difficult in the space I have here. So we'll do our overview, starting at the top. Again, as I said, these are the models of infantry rifle you'll find in the trapdoor series. And there are various muskets and cadet rifles, which were slightly smaller than the infantry rifles, were made for the West Point cadets. There are also some special limited release rifles with different types of bayonets and different types of sights and modifications. But these are all the standard ones. At the top is the model of 1865, which was the first Allin conversion, and it was started not long after the hostilities ended at the end of the Civil War. It's in the 58 rimfire round I showed you in the last scene. There's the model 1855 bayonet with its scabbard underneath it. This still used almost all the parts from the rifle musket, so it could use that bayonet. These were manufactured in 1866. Moving into the next year, right below that, is the model 1866, which wasn't manufactured until 1867. Again, it's just as long and uses most of the parts from the rifle musket, but this time we've changed the caliber down to 50 centerfire, which we know today as 50-70. And that was decided to be a better choice. Actually, the board had opted for a 45 caliber at this point, but President Grant decided that the 45 caliber cartridge was too long, and they opted for the 50 caliber cartridge instead for the next few years. This was the first model to actually see battle use against the Native Americans. Not long after that, they decided that the rifle didn't have to be as long as the musket, that the ballistics would still be good, so they shortened it up a few inches, and you get the rifle underneath there, which is the model of 1868. Still in 50-70, now it has a receiver instead of just a hole cut in the rear of the musket barrel. Underneath that, after they manufactured that for a while, the way they manufactured the barrels changed, which meant that the receiver didn't have to be as long. So you have the model of 1870, which is identical to the 1868, except it has a slightly shorter front to the receiver. We'll look at that later. Below that, the rifle with the sling is the model of 1873. They used the 50 caliber rifles up until 1873, and then they formed a new board and decided that, yes, they did like that 45 caliber cartridge after all, and they didn't run into trouble with the president this time. So they went for an entirely newly built rifle, the model of 1873 and 45-70 caliber. This has a it has basically all new parts. We're no longer using the old musket parts, except for the bayonet underneath it. That is a model 1855 bayonet. But the outside of the part that goes over the barrel has been cold pressed down so that it has a smaller diameter and will fit the 45 caliber barrel, which is now a different outside diameter than the 58 and 50 caliber barrels. See if I can keep the camera straight as we go down. And you will see references to model 1877, 78, and 79 rifles. Those were actually all model 1873s. This is a very early model 1873. Again, the rifle with the sling. And it has the 1873 model rear sight. This is a rifle that was built in 1874, so it was very, very early issued. They went through a lot of modifications. One was the model 1877 rear sight, which had taller sides to it and operated a little differently. The model 1879 rear sight was similar to the 1877. And those are sometimes referred to as 1877 and 79 rifles, but they're really 1873s with different sights. The model 1878 was simply a malfunctioning die. The top of the trapdoor itself has the year 1873 stamped in it. And at one point, when they were being stamped by this die, it looked like 1878. And people have just taken to calling it that, but they're really 1873s. The next new model is below the 1873, and it's the model 1884. And it has a few differences to it. Most notable is the rear sight, which is the Buffington's type rear sight. It's a very target type rear sight. That became the major model for the end of the production. Underneath there is a trowel bayonet. I believe it's the model 1879 trowel bayonet, which doubles as your spade as well as your bayonet. That was an idea to try to combine these things up. Underneath that is a model 1888 rifle. And that is basically a model 1884. As a matter of fact, the top of the trap still says 1884. But it was considered a new model, and the reason for this was they were beginning to run out of the surplus Civil War socket bayonets. They knew they were going to be adopting a new rifle at some point, and designing a new bayonet to go, or designing or putting into production a new bayonet to go on an old rifle just seemed like a bad idea. They'd already been playing with this idea of making the cleaning rod the bayonet, and there were some in 1880 and 1884, maybe 1886, I don't remember, that were sort of experimental runs that had them. But this was the standard rifle from 1888 to end of production, which I think was in 1893. So you have the rod bayonet, and we'll talk about all of these in turn. So here we have a model of 1865 rifle, also known as the First Allin Conversion. This is the first production version of the Trapdoor series. Now, it resembles a rifle musket very greatly because all except a few parts are from a model 1861 Springfield rifle musket. I don't know if I mentioned before, the ramrod on the rifle musket was held together by was held in the musket by a screw at the end of the rod that threaded into a plate, and also by this swell here that sort of sticks in the wood. And the model 1865 just continued to use the old ramrod. Now, I said before, the three different types of rifle musket had some differences, including the barrel bands. These flat barrel bands that are very wide are from the model 1861 rifle musket. I don't know if you saw that, but that is the three bands that those muskets had: the upper, the middle with the sling swivel, and the lower. So there were three types to choose from, and they decided to use the 1861s to start with. The lock plate is dated 1865. I don't know if you can see that. 1865 here, U.S. Springfield and the Eagle, which were the standard markings. Most 1865 rifles actually have 1865 dated lock plates, so it seems like when they began production, they just pulled the newest set of lock plates that had not yet been assembled into rifles and used them for these. The later rifles in the series will have older lock plates from muskets that were stripped down. Everything else, the trigger guard, the stock has, you can't see it very well on this rifle, we'll look on the next one. There are two cartouches back here, inspector's cartouches. This one is Erskine S. Allen, the man who invented the system, and he was responsible for inspecting these. It's in an oval. There's a square inspection here. That's from the original musket that utilized this stock. And you'll see two on these when they're using converted stocks. So everything else about the musket is the same as the rifle musket. The parts that we've added are all in this area. And this is where the trapdoor is. The rear sight is a slight modification of the former sight. You only have one leaf now. You have the 100-yard battle sight. You have a 300-yard hole drilled in it and a notch at the top for 500 yards. And again, it flips up. It tilts down toward the front. You'll notice this does not have that screw with the two little holes in it that the rifle musket did. These are brazed onto the barrel, and for some reason many of the model 1865s do not have the screw in there, which the earlier and later models will. What you do see here is the screw holding the actuator for the trapdoor is that same sight screw with the two little holes in it. There were two variants of this, the production model of the 1865, and this is an early variant where you will see that type of screw. And the hammer has a longer nose to it. There are later ones where there's a slot screw, just like the hammer screw here, and the nose to this hammer will be slightly shorter. So this is an early 1865. The hammer is a new piece because obviously the hammer on the percussion musket didn't sit as far to the left of the rifle, because the percussion nipple was right here where the actuator is. Now the hammer has to make it all the way over to the firing pin, and this, getting a little pointer out here, this is the end of the firing pin. It's spring-loaded. I can't really show you that very well from this angle. Just like the rifle musket, you've got half-cock notch, which is sort of a safety, and the full cock notch. I'm sure you were probably only supposed to come to half cock when you were opening the mechanism, but we're going to do that at full cock. You pull up on the lever, pop the whole thing open. And there's a lot of spring noise with this one that you're not going to notice with the later ones. So there's the back of the firing pin here again. See, I can push that down. This is part of the lock. It locks into a notch in the back of the back of the chamber there. Now this is a rifle musket barrel. It's actually dated 1862. The one is cut off and it's read upside down from the way we're looking at it, but it's 1862 dated barrel. And all they've done is cut this hole in it. Then they built this new door mechanism. You can see the top of it there. You notice when you push this down, this doesn't lock in place. You have to push that in place, and I believe that was the 1865s were like that. We've got a little notch here to allow you to see your sights. Now as you pull this up, a couple of things happen. You can see this moving along the side here, and another piece moving inside. We'll try to get closer up on those. There's a little rack and pinion going down here, and again we'll try to get closer in on it. And this is the extractor pulling back this way. There's a little piece sticking up in the bottom, and that's the ejector. And I'm going to rearrange this to try to get you up there where you can see it. So here we are, right down with the action, as close as I can manage to get the camera at this point. And we're looking at the right side. You can see this one's missing a little bit of wood along here. It was probably pretty thin and chipped away. That actually helps us to see what's going on. So we pull the lever up, and as you begin to pull this up, right inside here there are a series of teeth, and there's a little rack and pinion thing that's moving along with this piece here that's moving. And as we go up, it's pulling against spring tension. On the inside, we've got the extractor would be pulling the case back at this point. Now we roll up, and you can begin to see the teeth here. And we're about to let go. So this whole thing is going to snap back when we do that into place. That's that angle on it. And I'm going to have to turn the whole thing around to get you out inside. So here we are inside the action. And this little plate here is what slides back and forth. The extractor is all the way at the front of that. You can't see it quite at the moment because here's the actual chamber. Now I'm going to have to close it to reset it because it won't do anything from this position. Now as we begin to pull it up, you see that plate starting to come back. And if you look right there, that's the extractor. Now also notice while we're here, this hole, which you don't see anything in. So this is the extractor pulling the shell back, which is going to pull the rim of the shell across that hole before it snaps. And when it snaps, you're going to see the ejector pop up out of there, which would shoot the case right up out of the action when it's done. So there's the ejector coming up. The extractor's done its job. And the whole thing snaps back in. And that ejector only resets as you start to pull this out. So it helps keep the shell from sliding down backwards, I guess, too, if by some strength, you know, if you were opening it, I guess, with unfired, it keeps it from sliding out of the action until you actually work this. And there you go. Let me see if from this angle I can also show you these teeth a little better in this little rack and pinion setup. So there you can see the teeth very well on the piece that's moving. And you may just have to take my word for it, but there you go. If we go around there far enough, you can actually see some of the teeth on the curved part of the trapdoor itself. This is a kind of a unique part of the mechanism. You're not going to see this again in the upcoming versions of this. I'll try to get the bolt face here and find the... Anyway, I don't think I can. But this is a rim fire. So there's your firing pin all the way up there. And when the hammer hits the other end of it, it protrudes. And it doesn't have a double strike like a lot of rim fires did, just a single. They moved away from rimfire in the next model because of safety. They did some tests where they tumbled rounds together, and the rimfire rounds had more of a tendency to go off than the centerfire rounds did, so they opted for that. Here you can see, sort of unintentionally, but again, we just have a hole cut in the barrel back here, and they've cut another smaller hole to attach this screw, and that's what holds the entire trapdoor mechanism in. And we just have sight screw, and the distance between the three of these is going to change with the various models. So after a little over 5,000 of the model 1865s were made, a decision was made to go for a smaller caliber round than the 58 rimfire. Again, the board that was looking at this actually preferred the 45 caliber, but the president decided that that was not appropriate at the time, and they were overridden. So what was adopted was a 50 caliber round. This one, it's a center fire round. This one's internally primed. If you see the little notch down here near the rim, that's the holding the primer in. The base of this looks like a rim fire round, but there actually is a center fire primer inside there. We have a copper case, 450 grain bullet, 70 grains of black powder. That was for the rifle. When the carbine versions came out, there was a carbine round came out. This again is internally primed, and you see the shorter case, less powder. I'm not sure of the size of the bullet, but it does appear to be a different shape. You'd have to look that up
as to what size that was. You need to learn to look at the monitor and hold these where they're supposed to be. So we have a longer action because we now have a longer round than the 58 rimfire round. Again, these are very similar to the rifle musket, similar to the 1865 because they use all rifle musket parts except right in this area for the most part. The front end is the same except the cleaning rod is different. This is the model 1866 cleaning rod. Instead of using the ramrod from the old musket, we now have a straight cleaning rod with no swell in it. It screws in down at the other end into a plate in the stock, and we have a cleaning jag type head instead of the ramrod type head. Notice before, the 1865 had the 1861 style barrel bands. These are actually from an 1864 musket. The 1863 and 64 did away with the wider, flatter bands, and narrower, and this is somewhat thicker than the other bands. You notice the front band here is completely solid with no screw on it. The center band has the sling swivel, and the rear band is again solid. So these are from an 1864. I'll show you some from an 1863 later. The rear sight is similar, but now has a couple of holes in it. And now, instead of tilting down toward the muzzle, it tilts down toward the breech. So you have your 100-yard sight here. The numbers are printed on this side, and I believe there are 3 and 500 for the holes. I'm not sure if that notch on the top, you got the two holes in the notch. I believe the notch on the top is 700. And you notice under here we have that screw with the two holes in it, as was being used on the trapdoor on the 1865, but this is what they're normally used for, is to hold the sights to the barrel. The strap that holds the trapdoor device to the barrel has got two screws on it now, and it's longer. The top of the longer trapdoor has been redesigned a little bit. It's very flat on this one, this model, compared to the others. I'm not sure if I can get close enough. Yeah, I think we can see a little bit. There's an eagle head here, stamp, and 1866 for the model year. And you notice now on our little actuator lever, there's an actual slotted screw holding it in. This again is a musket barrel. It's just had a hole cut in it. You can't see that. It's a musket barrel that's just had a hole cut in it. I can't see the date on this one. There's a little bit of corrosion there. But again, there's no receiver. It's just a long hole and this strap attached. Now, one thing they did have to do was, we're going from 58 caliber, and we have a 58 caliber barrel, down to 50 caliber. So there was an insert placed in there, and we'll talk about that in a little bit. First, I want you to notice up on top of here, this, I believe this is the ejector, this little nipple that's sticking, or tip that's sticking out there. We've gotten rid of that whole rack and pinion spring popping thing that went on with the 1865. There is a spring in here, though, because when you open it up, it just kind of wants to fly open. And I'm going to have to move this around a little bit, send you right out of focus, because I'm not very good at that part yet. So pardon me while I get this right. I'm actually going to turn it all the way around. There we go. So this is the other side of that little ridge that you saw on the outside. And I believe as that comes around, that just contacts the rim, pulls it right out of the chamber, which is down in there. Not sure what that's for. This is fixed, and I believe that's the ejector. So as I said, that now locks, and it now comes open with some force. So you're gonna throw the case back right into that, and I believe that's a fixed ejector. It just knocks it right out. I could be wrong. Maybe you have to tip it out. I probably should have read that part. Anyway, you can get a nice view here of the interior of the little loading area, and I'm aiming for the bolt face here. If I can find the other end of the firing pin, there you can see that. Now we've got a center fire firing pin protruding when I push on it, and the hammer strikes it and sends that on its way. These were the first models of Trapdoor that were used in combat. They were used in the wagon box fight, which I'm not sure was in 1867 or 68. And they provided a little bit of surprise for the Plains Indians that the troops were fighting there, because they had learned over the last several years to differentiate between cavalry and infantry. The cavalry, of course, would have Sharp's carbines or maybe something like Spencer's that they could fairly quickly reload. But they had learned when they were fighting infantry to do a feint and draw their fire so that they wouldn't then have to reload their muzzle-loading muskets. Well, at Wagon Box, they did the feint and they drew fire, and then they turned around and charged again, and they got fired at again. So that proved the value of the breech-loading arm for the infantry. And I'm going to see if I can get a worked around here so you can see the muzzle, and we can talk about the barrel insert. This is about the best I'm going to do with this camera. I may have to throw you in a still picture. But what they did was they took the 58 caliber barrel and they bored out the rifling and bored out the inside, and they made inserts that they then rifled to 50 caliber. Originally, when they started building these, they bored them from the breech end and they put a shoulder in there which would kind of wedge it in place, and then they brazed it around the muzzle. I don't know if you can see this, but there's a line that runs all the way around here. This was used many other times, the Italian tubata inserts. The Finns did some Mosin-Nagants early on that had barrel inserts. There were some other people who did it. So you have a barrel in here that's 50 caliber, and it's inside what's left of the 58 caliber barrel. Later on, they got rid of the shoulder, and they inserted a uniform diameter insert, and they brazed it both at the muzzle and at the breech. See, this one's been dinged pretty good over here. So you've got two separate pieces working against each other. And that was used throughout 1866 production. They made about 52,000 of them in 1867 through 1869. And they learned a little bit with them before they moved on to the next model. So after a few years service with the 1866 rifle, they learned a few things and decided they could change some things about it. We retained the trapdoor mechanism and the 50-70 round. One of the things they decided was that it didn't have to be as long as the rifle musket. The ballistics were fine if you shortened the barrel up a little bit. So we dropped the overall length of the rifle by about 4 inches. The barrel itself is about 32 inches, and instead of cutting a hole in the back of the barrel, which was didn't make for the strongest action, we now have a separate forged receiver. It goes out to here. It was originally case hardened, which is why it's a different color from the polished barrel. So starting at the back, everything's the same. It's an old cut down Civil War era stock. You have an 1863 Springfield dated lock plate. The metal furniture is all reused. This type of barrel band, instead of being solid but with the screw on the bottom, is from an 1863 musket. And now we only need to use two of them because of the shorter barrel. So the sling swivel moves up to the upper band. Again, we have a different cleaning rod. We've gotten rid of screwing the back end of it into a plate. We now have this little bulge here that fits over a clip. Same sort of jag tip. Now you pull it down and it's hard to do holding it this way, but you pull it down and pull it out of the rifle. Front sight, pretty similar. Now, originally these were built, about the first half of the production was built in the same way that the 1866s were, with the 58 caliber barrel and the 50 caliber insert that was brazed inside it. Partway through they decided that just wasn't worthwhile anymore, and they started making newly manufactured barrels. So we're getting to fewer and fewer parts used from the muskets. The lock plate, the furniture, the wood is all still from the musket, but now the barrel is a new piece on this one. And of course this receiver is a new piece. And we can see over here that it takes up the place of the old barrel plug. Actually, that is a separate piece there, but the receiver starts here, goes around the trapdoor, and then is lengthened. And I know we're upside down, but you can see these had serial numbers. The other rifles did not, but they started serial numbering these, I guess, when they started making the receiver. We have a ladder type rear sight now, which folds down toward the breech. You can see there's a little battle notch there, probably 100 yards again. This is numbered up to 900 yards, and the notch on the very top above the screw, I assume, would be 1,000. Again, held in with one of these screws. And we have a slider. It doesn't really lock in place. It just sort of slides up there. It's kind of grungy. I should clean that. But you can, when you fold it up, you can see the length of that front of the receiver. This was made very long because the barrel has to screw into here. And when they were making the barrels with the 50 caliber insert, they were worried about them, I guess, working loose as they screwed them in. So they made this longer than it needed to be to ensure that they had a lot of thread area that was connecting the two. And we'll see the result of not needing to do that in just a moment. So, same deal, we cock that. Again, this is shaped somewhat differently. We have an Eagle and a US, and I don't believe there's a year on this one. I'm going to take a peek from a different angle. I don't see a year. It may say 1868, but my eyes are just not picking it up. And anyway, you just sort of throw this open again, and we have a different sort of thing now. And I probably should have read about this, but it would appear this has to do with the ejector here. You notice that this little tip moves up and hits that part of the receiver. Then this stays static while the rest of this turns. And yes, down here where you cannot hope to see it, again, it looks like we have the fixed ejector. Well, that's easy enough to see from there. Let me get this turned around. Here's the end of the firing pin. Down inside here. Wow. Learning with me, aren't you? That looks like an ejector right there. That probably snaps when you do this. Yeah, I'm gonna guess that's the only thing that... Sorry. Right there, that little piece of metal. But that is the basis of that. And they made these from 1869 to 1871 when they modified and made another. So sitting up front here, we now have a model of 1870. And the major difference between the two is the length of this area. As I said, we're now manufacturing new barrels, so they're not worried about the two dissimilar materials in the barrel and the need for a long threaded area. They decided they could reduce the amount of material that they made the receiver out of. Let's go ahead and pull the 1868 up behind it here. And if we put them in a similar area, you can see how much longer the nose is on the 1868 than it is on the 1870. Other than that, we're still using old Civil War materials. For most of the other things, the lock plate on this one is dated 1863. And I want you to notice here that all these old musket lock plates stand proud of the wood, and they're all beveled back in a little bit. That'll become important in a moment. On this particular example, we have the solid bands of the 1864 style musket. Front band, of course, has the sling swivel. And just to make things even more difficult, we've actually changed the cleaning rod again. Whereas the 1868 style just had this bulge. Now we have bulges on either side of the little clip that holds it in place. And again, I'm holding it at the worst possible angle to do this, but you can pull that out. We still have, believe it or not, over here, the inspector's cartouches. You can't really see them on this one. We've lost the serial numbers, though. They decided, I guess, after they worked out the whole receiver thing, that they didn't really need serial numbers again. And this one's been cleaned pretty severely, but this whole thing would have been case-hardened at one time. Can I see that? So there you got the eagle on top again, and now it does say Model 1870. Actually on there. There, I think we can see it there. Other than that, it works just the same way as the other one. You've got the little extractor there. And that's what you hear popping inside there, is that extractor, the fixed ejector. And this was the summit of the 1870 issue rifle. I mean, the 5070 issue rifle in 1870. And these were probably manufactured, I actually didn't look, but from 1871 through about 1873, I would imagine, because in 1873, something else happened. So by 1873, they had decided that they could do better ballistically than that 50 caliber round. And a board was convened to review small arms and come up with a new design for a rifle. This is the point where a lot of people say they should have gotten rid of the trapdoor. Maybe for cavalry you could make a point for that. If you look at what's going on in most of Europe at the time with the rifles, the trapdoor was not that far out of the swing of things still. It made sense. One of the reasons that people say they should get rid of it is these rifles were now essentially made of all new parts. Some small pieces of the furniture might have been left over, but most of them were newly made parts. We'll get to that in a moment, but the cartridge they decided on was a 45 caliber cartridge with 70 grains of powder, 405 grain bullet, so it became the 45-70 government. There was also 45-55, which was the carbine round. I'm not 100% sure I have one of those. These are just two examples of Indian Wars era 45-70 rounds. And they were made in two different, they're all center fire, but they're made in different fashions. They've got regular exposed center fire. If I can get this turned around the right way, it's October of 1878. You can see on the head stamp with a brass cartridge case, and that became the standard. Earlier on, you had a copper internally primed case. Again, you can see the little notches there that hold the primer in. And then we have a head stamp on this of June of 1881. But these eventually fell out of favor for the more familiar type cartridges. Excuse me, as I said, we have a whole new, almost wholly new built rifle. And this particular rifle is an early pattern, 1873. These do have serial numbers now on the receivers, and this one dates to 1874, and the rifle is put together in a way that is all pretty much parts from 1874. A lot of these were updated over the years, and a lot of them wound up as spare parts, so it's very possible this was put back together in this format, but it's nice because it represents the way the rifles were when they were first issued to the infantry. Now, the shape of the stock and everything is the same. You have a little rack number up here. In fact, we have another marking on the other side I'll get back to. But if you look at the lock plate, we were just talking about, you notice the shape appears a little different from the side, and we were talking about how those other lock plates were proud of the wood, and you notice this is completely inset into the wood. And in fact, the edges of the plate are beveled in the opposite direction, whereas the muskets were beveled that way, they're beveled this way, to fit neatly into the wood. Now we've got the eagle and U.S. Springfield 1873. Now, only the early ones had the date on them. That's the model date, not the year they were built. Now, later, they just went back to U.S. Springfield and didn't bother to put the date there. We've got solid type rear band, The upper band now has a sling swivel and a stacking swivel. That's something new. We have a cleaning rod that is more or less like the 1868, except it's now blue. Do you notice that everything was polished before, and now we've gone to the barrel and all that sort of thing being blued. As I said, this is set up as an early rifle. Here's the 1873 rear sight, which is looking a little more modern. We've got a battle sight, and then you can elevate it on the steps, or you can pull it all the way up for the markings. And it looks to be marked to 1,100 yards at this line, which probably means 1,200 yards at the very top when you pull it up. So an altogether different style of sight than we'd had before. More of a target sight, although not really set up for windage. Same sort of lock or trap. Got the same sort of extractor, it looks like. The whole thing pops up. There's your ejector. Now, one thing about these early 1873s is they had, I don't know if it's high hump or high curve, whatever they call it, but this big curve here in the trapdoor, that was seen as a weak point later on. So more metal, more meat was put in here. This is a very early one. But it works the same way, and apologies, here's where the serial number is on all of them, and they run up into the 400,000s. If I go around to the other side, even these screws are bushed a little different than the originals were. We have just the one cartouche now, inspector's cartouche. And the reason I came around to this side is this one has been marked to Company B, 1st Infantry. Which is kind of an interesting thing. And you've got a rack number with a B in it up there, which works with that Company B part. One of the other things that changed, one of the few items that remained possibly left over from the Civil War would have been the bayonet. The scabbards changed over time. There are whole collections of these different types of frogs and scabbards. Bayonets at this point, even though it's now blued again and it's not polished, is the 1855 bayonet. And these were pressed. Just this whole thing was pressed down because the diameter of the 45 caliber barrel is less than the 58 caliber barrel, and they continued to be used for several years as they still had stocks of these. Now, I did say it before when we were doing the overview, but these were essentially built from 1874 through 1884, and they had several different types of rear sight, but the action stayed the same. As I said, the date went away on there. There is a 1873 on top of here with the eagle. In 1877, they adopted a different sight that had a much higher thing. I guess it followed the bullet's trajectory, a rounded edge here and a different style of actual notch that you look through. In 1879, they adopted a different one again, and those were the model 1877 and 79 sights, but not the whole model of the rifle didn't change. There were 1873 rifles with 1877 or 79 sights. And the model 1878 people talk about again was just a die where it said 1873, but it actually looked like 1878. So those were all 1873 rifles. This is a period sling, which says upside down from this angle, Rock Island Arsenal and inspector's initials. It has one hook on it like the more familiar model 1907 sling. I'm not exactly sure of the model here of that. I have to look it up. So the 4570 model 1873 took the Army through the 1870s and into the 1880s. And the only change that really came after that was to the rear sight. There was a lot of experimentation going on with different things this time. I recommend some of the books on the subject to tell you about this. But there was a great emphasis on marksmanship and particularly long-range target shooting that became popular in the Army at this time. So an individual named Buffington came up with this sight, and it's very adjustable for windage and elevation and all kind of knobs and peep sights and things on it. And this is the Buffington sight that was to form the basis of some of the later sights used on later models of rifles. Most of the rest of the rifle is pretty similar. One thing that changed, and I'm unsure why, the tumbler for the hammer now has three positions on it. So you have half cock, I guess three quarters cock, and full cock, instead of just the two from before. The trapdoor remains basically unchanged. It now says model 1884 on the top, because this is a model 1884. A lot of model 1884s are in pretty decent shape. You can see the case hardening on this one. There's a serial number. Everything else is pretty similar to the 1873 here. The extractor, ejector remain the same. The lock plate remains the same. It doesn't have a date on it now. It's the same length. It's got the same, you know, it's blued, basically. It's lost some knurling up here on the cleaning rod. The cleaning rod has changed again, but it's held the same way. You've still got a stacking swivel. We now have a date cartouche over here that says 1889 on this one, together with the inspector's initials. But it hasn't changed all that much except for that sight. One other thing we have here, and I'm unsure, I thought this was an 1879 date, but I just was reading about them and there were all kinds of trowel bayonets. It seemed like a good idea at the time. They decided instead of issuing an entrenching tool and a bayonet, we'll just issue an entrenching tool that is a bayonet. And like so many good ideas like that, it doesn't work as well as a combination tool as either of them do on their own. This particular one fits on just like the old socket bayonets. You have a part that slides over the sight, and then you just rotate that into place, and you have your trowel bayonet attached to the rifle. The final iteration of the infantry rifle, as far as we're concerned today with the trapdoor, is the model 1888. By the late 1880s, this design was clearly obsolete. All kinds of things were happening, smokeless powder magazine loading, and the Army knew that was coming when they could get the money and the time for it. Until then, they had to keep making what they had. The tooling was in place, the production line was in place. And by now, we were building basically all new parts for these anyway. The one thing that had been left with the 1884 was the bayonet. That was left over from the Civil War parts, and they were running out of those. And there was no way they were going to set up production of a new bayonet or restart production of an obsolete bayonet for an obsolete rifle. So they had already been playing with some different ideas, including the trowel bayonets, etc., but several times during the 1880s, the idea of combining the cleaning rod and the bayonet showed up. And these were mostly an experimental batches of rifles. Well, in 1888, the bayonet issue came to a head, and they decided to redesign the rifle. Now, in most ways, it's still an 1884. It still says 1884 on the top of the action. The action is identical to the 1884s. The serial number range is continued. It has the three-position tumbler. It has the Buffington rear sight from the 1884. Everything about it up to this point is quite similar. When you get up to the muzzle, though, we have this contraption. Well, there's a sight hood that goes over the sight, but that's a clamp-on piece. I suppose you could put that on any of them. But here we have this little thing. There's a button where my finger is, and there's a button here, and that holds the cleaning rod in place. You can see as I hope you can see as I push that, it rotates just a little bit. And also, while we've got it at this angle, you can see that this is not your normal jag tip. This is kind of cut with three grooves around it, which leaves three pointy bits, and that is the tip of your bayonet. So as I push this in, you can pull this out. You see there's a notch right here that locks it in place. And as we come further out, there's another notch, which is now right there, and that's going to lock into this and click in place. So now we have this thin pointy bit sticking out, and that's your bayonet. So if you thought that the story about the 1903 rod bayonet came out of thin air, well, it didn't. It was started from this. And I think that's actually where it's supposed to be locked, because there's a notch there and there's a notch there that are both locked in place, which makes an even longer thin bayonet-like bit come out. Now the back end of this cleaning rod in the normal place is threaded, but I will tell you that this particular example, the threads are all chewed up, because I just tried to do this a little while ago. I'll put this back in place so I don't stab myself or something else with it. Because there's one more thing, the very rear end of the rifle, that has changed. All the butt plates on these rifles and the rifle muskets up till now have been solid. The 1888 picks up a little trap back here, and there's just a little bit of a few lines machined into it, so you can push it with your thumb, and you get two openings machined into the butt. I suppose the other one's for some kind of cleaning kit. So this has this little piece of metal in here, which I'm going to tip out, and you won't be able to see me do it. What I would like to be able to do, if you can see it down inside here, I don't think I'm going to be able to angle the camera properly, but take my word for it, inside there where that was, there's actually a screw drilled this way to keep this little thing from falling in there. And this is a wiping tip for your cleaning rod. So it's threaded on that end. And the end of the cleaning rod, I told you, was all chewed up. You put this on there, and instead of using the bayonet end, you use this end to do your cleaning, so you don't damage the bore. Excuse me. Well, that is pretty much the end of our tour of the Trapdoor Springfield. And my battery is running out right at the same time. So I'll see you later.